back to the question of factor impacting the geographic order of the species. We talked about temperature, precipitation, and soil type. How the soil type can influence this?
So the set of factors, the question is how does soil type influence distributions of species? In many cases it doesn't, in many cases it does. We have some botanists here, and they can probably tell us that a sandy soil versus a loamy soil versus a laterite soil makes all the difference in the world to a plant. Birds usually don't care, right? So one of the steps that Enrique is going to be talking about is that of establishing which environmental parameters are probably the relevant parameters for the species that you're studying. Which is to say, we can't just take, okay, here are my 100 environmental dimensions that work for all species. A bird, a plant, whatever, they're all going to have very different sets of factors that are important. Okay? But certainly soils, plants, or soils and fossorial species. Soils are pretty critical, either in terms of providing structure, right, maybe you have to know what burrows into the soil, and in terms of providing nutrients to plants. Okay. Other questions on the conceptual side?
I'm just curious to know, if you can conceptualize the distribution of a species, as in the case of Aedes albopictus, can you use the same arguments for the removal of a species, potential perturbations of the other species in the ecosystem?
Okay, so the question is, could we take this conceptualization or an extension of it and talk about removing species? I think the answer is yes and no. That's usually the answer to all questions in science. It depends on how we would remove it. If you could manipulate the conditions of an area such that those conditions were now outside of the ecological tolerances of the species, then you can imagine on that conceptualization of ENM, you can imagine the A circle contracting and leaving more areas out. Okay? But that's the idea that you could change the environment in some sense of the place. And so beyond that sort of rather odd example that this gave you, maybe this framework doesn't work so well. Usually with disease vectors, what you do is accumulate, right? Or you eliminate breeding places. And so that's okay, in a way that's changing the abiotic environment, right? A mosquito does not reproduce very well in the BITC in the air. So maybe we're pushing the limits of that very simple Venn diagram framework, but it at least helps us to think about these things. One more question? There we go. Then we're going to move on because we're trying to catch up already.
Wondering on the issue of physiological responses, like for some organisms, they are able to at least adjust, like that's sort of like plasticity. As in the manner in which an abiotic stress happens, might sort of determine the response of that insect. Hence, is it rapid or is it gradual? If it's gradual, it can actually acquire some resistance, like against a certain environmental stress. So how does that get accounted for in the concept of fundamental nature and realization?
So it's a very, very good question. If I go from, or an insect goes from 10 degrees to 30 degrees in the space of a second, it's very different than going from 10 to 30, maybe increasing 1 degree per day or 1 degree per month. So I think that we can certainly bring in temporal considerations in the idea of niche. For example, where you run into trouble is almost always the occurrence data. And so one thing that I have looked for years and years, because I'm interested in disease vector, population and distribution dynamics, years